वेलकम टू दिस चैनल गेन जावा नॉलेज एंड टुडे इन दिस वीडियो वी विल डिस्कस हाइबरनेट इंटरव्यू क्वेश्चंस एंड आंसर्स। एज वी नो हाइबरनेट इज वन ऑफ द मोस्ट वाइडली यूज्ड ओआरएम टूल फॉर जावा एप्लीकेशंस एंड इट इज यूज्ड ए लॉट इन एंटरप्राइज एप्लीकेशंस फॉर डाटाबेस ऑपरेशन। सो आई डिसाइडेड टू मेक ए वीडियो अबाउट हाइबरनेट इंटरव्यू क्वेश्चंस टू ब्रश अप योर नॉलेज बिफोर द इंटरव्यू। Whether you are a fresher or experienced, having good knowledge or Hibernate tool helps in cracking interview. And here I am providing important Hibernate interview questions with answers to help you brush up your knowledge and impress your interviewer. Okay, let's start. And the first interview question, that is, what is Hibernate? And as we know, Hibernate, it is an open source, lightweight, non-invasive, Java-based ORM framework. And it is used to develop object-based database software independent OR mapping. And also perform persistence logic in all kind of Java applications and in Java frameworks. Here, it is open source means when we will download Hibernate software installation, then we will also get its source code. And Hibernate is lightweight means its installation of Hibernate software takes less memory in MBs. And non-invasive means it will not implement any class or any interface that is related to Hibernate interface. So we just need to create simple model class and define annotations or XML configurations. And Hibernate is ORM framework because it allows to develop object-based OR mapping persistence logic by internally using JDK technology. And the next question is, what are the main features of Hibernate and why we need to use Hibernate? Because Hibernate gives HQL, that is Hibernate query language, and as database software independent. And by default Hibernate supports lazy loading, and we can also provide eager loading. For this we need to do some configurations. And third one is, it allows to develop object based persistence logic in standalone environment and also in web application environment. And here, does not need the heavyweight container or server to execute the Hibernate code, so we can say it is lightweight. And Hibernate OR mapping solve the mismatches between Java programming and database programming, means that table we have created or we have created model class always will check by Hibernate framework. And Hibernate support both XML and annotation based OR mapping. For OR mapping we can create configuration files and we can also use its annotations. It supports two levels of caching to reduce the network round trips between Hibernate and database software. So it supports two level of cache, that is L1, level 1 cache and level 2 cache. And the next, Hibernate supports versioning. If you want to keep track of how many times the object or record is modified in database, then we can use versioning feature of Hibernate framework. For this we just need to define one annotation, that is @version on property level. And the next one is, it supports timestamping feature. It is used to keep track of when object or record is saved or modified with date and time values. For this we just need to define annotation, that is @temporal. And the next one is, it gives support to native SQL query to develop persistence logic. And it also supports object level relationship like 1-to-1, 1-to-many, many-to-1 and many-to-many. And since Hibernate allows to develop object-based database software independent persistence logic, so we can change the database software in the middle of development or production environment, because it automatically allow to create that table in database. And the next one is, what is Hibernate configuration file? It is a file that contains information to establish the connection with the database software and to provide instruction to Hibernate framework. And here I have just created one sample project, and this is the Hibernate configuration files. So what it contains? Hibernate configuration file contains connection with the database properties and also Hibernate properties, and also contain Hibernate mapping file names, these three fields. So here we can see Hibernate configuration file. It contains database connection properties. It is our Hibernate connection URL, database, and its username, password. And next one is Hibernate properties. And next one is its mapping classes. So these will be stored in our configuration file. And the next one is, what are the three core concepts of Hibernate framework? The three core concept is configuration, session factory, and session. So let's start discussion about what is configuration. And when Hibernate configuration object is created, then Hibernate framework will be activated based on the jar file that are added to class path or build path. And our Hibernate configuration object also read the data and verify the given configuration file, and also read mapping file entry, and then it will store this information in memory metadata at RAM level in the form of hash map object. So next time if we need to read this file, it will automatically get this information from in memory metadata and not read all time again and again. So this is the example. To activate Hibernate framework, we can use standard service registry object, and we need to call configure method. And if we are not passing any file name here, then it will automatically read hibernate.cfg.xml. If we have created file with any other name, then we just need to define here the name of the file. Then we will build this. And the next one is session factory. As we know, it will be created based on standard service registry object. So this object will hold all connection properties and Hibernate configuration file information and its mapping file information and other details. So it is called heavyweight object in Hibernate programming, and it is immutable object. It means once the data placed in that object, it cannot be modified. And if it is immutable, then we can say it is thread safe object, because all immutable objects are thread safe object by default. So it is a factory to create Hibernate session objects. And in coding level, we can create session factory object like this. Here we need to use new metadata source, and here we need to pass service standard registry object as a parameter. Then we will call build metadata, and then it will build session factory. And the next one is session. As we know, session factory object gets one connection object from its JDBC connection pool and uses that object to create Hibernate session object. So the session object will be used to open the connection between Java application and database software through Hibernate framework, and it is the base object for programmer to give persistence instruction to Hibernate framework using domain class object. So if we want to perform any save operation, delete operation, and update operation, then we must need to create session object. Then only we can instruct to Hibernate framework to save the object or delete the object. And it is not thread safe object by default, but we can use thread locale to make session object as thread safe. So like this, we can get the session object by calling open session method or get current session. And the next one is, what is Hibernate dialect? Here we can see we have defined Hibernate properties. So this is the Hibernate dialect properties, and it is optional property. It is not mandatory to define. And it is an optional property of Hibernate configuration file, but it is a recommended property to use, because it helps the Hibernate framework to decide the destination database software to communicate. And it helps Hibernate framework to generate Optimize SQL as required for underlying database software. So like this line we need to use in our Hibernate configuration file to define Hibernate dialect class. So if we are using MySQL dialect, then we can use this property as a dialect. And the next one is, what is the difference between session.save and session.persist methods? The session.save method and session.persist both are used to save the object into database. So if we are using session.save, it is used to return the generated identity value. If we want to return the identity value of the object, then we need to use session.save. If we don't want to return any serializable object or its identity ID, then we need to use session.persist, because it does not return the generated identity value and its return type is void. And these are the signatures for those methods. Public serializable save, save method return type is serializable object, and persist method return type is void. So the next one is, what is the difference between session.load and session.get method? If we want to perform early loading or eager loading, then we need to use session.get method. And if we want to perform lazy loading, then we need to call session.load method. These both get and load used to fetch the record from database, and it will just fetch single entry. And it does not create any proxy object. If we are using session.load to get the object from database, then it will create one proxy object. It means we can get the object from this session.load on demand. And session.get create only one object for domain class to load single record. But it will create two objects. One will be the proxy object and second will be the read object for domain class to load only single record. And the fourth one is, it does not throw any exception if record not found. Means if we are getting the record from database, like we have passed here ID 1 and record is not present, then it does not throw any exception if record not found. But if we are using session.load and here we are passing the identity ID of the record and it is not available in database, then it will throw exception. So it will be suitable to check whether the record is available or not. And we need to use session.load if we are sure about object that is available in database, then we need to use session.load. If we are not sure about object, then we need to use session.get. And the next one is, use this method when loaded record will be used immediately. If we want to use object on demand or lately, then we need to use session.load function. And the next one is, what is the difference between session.save or session.save or update methods? So session.update or session.save or update methods. So session.update will be used if we want to update the record by using update SQL query. So it will not save, it will just perform update operation if record is found. And session.save or update function will be used to update the record if record is already available. Otherwise, it will insert the record. For this, it is internally generated select query and also generated inserted or update SQL query. And the next one is, what is the difference between session.save or update and session.merge methods? These both functions have the same functionality, means both will be used to update the object in database. And when we need to use session.save and when we need to use session.merge. And it's, as we know, it does not return any object representing the record that will inserted or updated, because session.save or update function return type is void, so it will not return any object. And if we call session.save or update to update the object with same identity value that is already there in first level cache, then we will get exception, non-unique object exception, because this object is already available in our session. And if we are using session.merge function to update the record, then it returns object representing the record that is inserted or updated. Means its return type is object. And if we call session.merge to update the object with same identity value that is already there in first level cache of session object, then it will not throw any exception. Moreover, given object modification will be synchronized with database table records. So when we need to use session.save, if we are using only single session and updating the record, then we need to go for session.save or update. If we are using multiple session in our application and trying to update the object, then we need to go for session.merge. So this is a main notes that we need to remember. If you modify the same record by loading the record or object in multiple session, then to merge all modification and reflect the changes into database table, then we need to use session.merge method. If we are just using single session, then we should go for save or update function. And the next one is, what is cache and types of cache in Hibernate? What is cache? Cache is a temporary memory that holds data for temporary period. In client service environment, the cache at client side holds data given by server and uses that data across the multiple same request to reduce the round trips between client and server. For example, if we are going to getting the record from database with same ID, then first time it will get the record from database, but the next time it will always get the data from cache. But it holds the data for a temporary period. And Hibernate supports two levels of cache. One is first level cache and second is second level cache. So now we will discuss what is first level cache. What is first level cache? And we can also say what is session cache. And we can also say it is L1 cache. So L1 cache, that is associated with session object and on one per session object basis. And it is built in cache for every session object. For this, we no need to define any configuration. And the data of one session cache cannot be used in another session cache. And the Hibernate uses L1 cache in two cases. First case is when we ask Hibernate to load the same object or record from database for multiple times. For example, in our database, we have 10 records. And we need to load the first 5 records multiple times, then it will take the help from L1 cache. So what it will do? It will load that record only one time from database and keeps that object in L1 cache to use it for multiple times. And this avoids multiple SQL query generation and object creation and also reduce the network round trips. And the performance will be improved of the application. So here we can see the example of L1 cache. Here I have just created employee object and loaded the object session.get function called. So when first time I will call session.get and it will hit first time it will hit to the database and load the object and saved into employee1 variable and also stored that object in L1 cache. And second time if I will again hit session.get and will pass the same ID is 1, then it will load the record and save, and next time it will get this object from L1 cache. And third time if I will again hit same object session.get employee.class and will pass the ID as a 1, same ID, then it will get the record from L1 cache. So in this example, the hit will goes to database only one time by generated single select query and uses that object for multiple times by keeping in L1 cache. So here we can see for first hit H1 gets record from database and also keeps in L1 cache. For second hit gets the record from L1 cache. And for third hits also getting the record from L1 cache. And the second use case of Hibernate L1 cache is in a transaction. if we are creating any transaction in our application. In a transaction, if persistent state object is modified for multiple times, means we are getting the record from database based on its ID 1 and we are trying to update some field value in this object, then it will keep this object in L1 cache until we are commit the record. So we can say, in a transaction, if persistent state object is modified for multiple times, then instead of generating multiple update queries to reflect the modification in database table, it will keep track of all the modification of that object in L1 cache till the end of transaction. So once the transaction is committed, then it will generate only single update query with all modifications to reflect the modification in database table. So here we can see the example. First, we are trying to get the record from database by using employee.class ID 1. So it will get the record from DB. And here we have created one transaction and transaction is null. So in try block, I have begin the transaction and now I am going to perform some changes in that object employee. So here I have updated set address. After that, again updated the address. And next, I have updated its last name. And then I will perform transaction.commit. When I will type transaction.commit, then it will generate single update query having all the modification. So it will be mainly used to improve the performance of application. So this all was about L1 cache. Now the next one is how to control L1 cache in Hibernate. If we just want to remove single object from our L1 cache, then we can call session.evict function and need to pass employee as a parameter. And if we want to clean all the object from L1 cache, then we can call session.clear. And we can also use session.close function that is used to close L1 cache along with session. And the next one is why we need hibernate.hbm2tdl.auto property. Here we can see in our configuration files, we have already defined this property, that is hibernate.hbm2tdl.autoupdate. If you will not define this property, then by default, it will use validate. So here we can see Hibernate allows to create or alter database tables based on the configuration done in Hibernate mapping files. And this option is useful to add new columns in the middle of project development or in the production environment of the project. And this property is also useful to create database table dynamically. If the database is changed in the middle of the project development or in the production environment, then we can use it to generate tables dynamically. But it is not recommended, and do not use this option to design database table of project, because this will be taken care by database designing team before coding of the project. And for this property, we have four values. Like here we can also type create, update, and also use validate or create or drop. If we are using here create, then it will create database table automatically every time when the application will start. And next one is update. If we are performing any changes in our entity class, then it will automatically update the table in database table, but will not create new and also create new tables. And validate is default if you are not using any property here, Hibernate HBM2DDL, and not defining this property, then by default it will be use validate and it will just check the mapping of files. And fourth one is create drop. So when the session factory object will be created, it will create the table, and when we close the application, it will automatically destroy all the tables. And the next one is what are the different states of object in Hibernate. So there are three different states of object in Hibernate. First one is transient state, second is persistent, and third one is detached state. So what is transient state. When the object is in transient state, if it is just assigning null value or created but has no primary key identifier and not associated with session, then we can say object in transient state. And the next one is persistent. So here we can see it is our domain class or entity class, and here what we did, we just created employee emp and assigning null value, then we can say our object in transient state. And if we are using employee emp and using new operator to create the object of this entity class, then we can also say object in transient state, but now it is not associated with any session, so it is just transient state. And we can make transient state object as persistent state by calling save method, persist method, update method, save or update, merge, get, load, any function. If you are calling, then it will convert it into transient to persistent state. And we can make object persistent state as transient state by just calling delete method. So next one we will discuss persistent state object. The object is in persistent state if object is associated with any session. Means if we are calling session.save and passing the employee object, then we can say it is in persistent state. So here we can see the example. Here I have created employee class object, that is our entity class. Then our object in transient state. After that we have created transaction and transaction is begin. And now we are calling session.save. When we will call session.save and pass the object entity object, then it will associated with our session object. Then we can say our object in persistent state. And persistent state object reside in first level cache, that is L1 cache of session. And the third state of the object is detached state. When the object is in detached state, if session is closed. So by calling session.close, evict or clear method, we can make persistent state object as detached state object. So these was the three main state of object: transient, persistent and detached. And the next one is what is object versioning and how to enable this feature in our Hibernate application. The process of keeping track of how many times the loaded object is modified through Hibernate persistence logic is known as versioning. If we are performing direct change in database, then it will not keep track. It will just keep track the record how many times if we are performing persistence operation through Hibernate framework. For this, if we want to implement this feature in our project, then what we need to do, we just need to define one annotation, that is @version annotation at column level, @column. Here we need to define the column name, and we need to define one property in our entity class, that is private, and its return type int version. Its data type will be integer. And the next one is what is timestamp feature in Hibernate and how to enable it. The process of keeping track of when each object or record is inserted or updated, it hold the date and time of the record that is inserted or updated. If you want to enable timestamp feature in our Hibernate application, then we need to use @temporal annotation. And here we can use temporal type dot date, or we can also use temporal type dot timestamp. And for this we need to create one extra column in DB, and here we will type private date modified, and date will be the its return type. So it will keep track how when the record is created or updated. And the next one is what is composite identity field. If primary key constant is applied on multiple columns of database table, then it is called composite primary key constant. Because most of the times primary key constant is applied only on single column, that is its primary key. If we are applying primary key constant on two columns, then we can say it is composite key. So here we can see there is no duplicate value based on two values. टू कॉलम्स, दैट इज आर ए नोएडा, ब्रैन दिल्ली, जॉन नोएडा, आर ए चेन्नई, सो देयर इज नो डुप्लीकेसी बिकॉज दिस इज अ प्राइमरी की एंड इट इज नोन एज कॉम्पोजिट आइडेंटिटी फील्ड. एंड द नेक्स्ट वन इज वट आर जनरेटर्स इन हाइबरनेट. हाइबरनेट गिव्स सेट ऑफ प्री डिफाइंड एल्गोरिदम्स एज आइडेंटिटी वैल्यू जनरेटर टू जनरेट आइडेंटिटी वैल्यू फॉर हाइबरनेट डोमेन क्लास ऑब्जेक्ट वाइल सेविंग देम टू डाटाबेस. हाइबरनेट जनरेटर्स विल ऑटोमेटिकली जनरेटेड इट्स आइडेंटिटी वैल्यू वेन वी विल ट्राई टू सेव द ऑब्जेक्ट इन टू डाटाबेस बाई यूजिंग हाइबरनेट परसिस्टेंस लॉजिक. सो ऑल द जनरेटर क्लास इम्प्लीमेंट्स द ओ आर जी डॉट हाइबरनेट डॉट आई डी डॉट आइडेंटिफाई जनरेटर इंटरफेस एंड द एप्लीकेशन प्रोग्रामर में क्रिएट वंस ओन जनरेटर क्लासेज बाई इम्प्लीमेंटिंग द आइडेंटिफायर जनरेटर इंटरफेस. सो हाइबरनेट फ्रेमवर्क प्रोवाइड्स मैनी बिल्ट इन जनरेटर क्लासेज लाइक असाइंड जनरेटर, इंक्रीमेंट जनरेटर, सीक्वेंस जनरेटर, हीलो, नेटिव आइडेंटिटी सीक्वेंस हीलो, यू यू आई डी, जी यू आई डी, सेलेक्ट, फॉरन, सीक्वेंस आइडेंटिटी. सो दीज आर द डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ जनरेटेड जनरेटर दैट आर सपोर्टेड बाई हाइबरनेट फ्रेमवर्क. And we can also create our own custom generator. Then we need to implement this interface org.hibernate.id identifier generator interface. And the sometime interviewer may ask which one is the default generator in Hibernate. Then we can say assigned generator is the default generator if we are not configured any generator. And the next one is what is the difference between identity and increment generator in Hibernate. So here we can see identity generator and increment generator. Identity generator, it is database software dependent, so it supports only few database softwares. And increment, it is database software independent, means we can use this generator with any database. If you are using MySQL, Oracle, any database, we can use increment generator. And if we are using identity generator, then ID field mapped column must have auto increment constraint. But if we are using increment generator, then ID field mapped column not required. And the main thing that we need to know, it also considered deleted value while generating new ID value. And if we are using increment generator, then deleted value does not consider while generating new ID value. Means if we are using identity generator and we are going to save 5 objects into database, then it will generate its ID like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And if we are deleting record number 5 from database, then we have just 4 records, 1, 2, 3, 4. And again we are going to save 5 more records, then it will generate its identity ID from 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So it will also consider deleted ID is 5. So 5 will not generate it again. But if we are using increment generator, then again 5 ID will be generated if we have deleted. Okay, thanks for watching this video. In next video, we will discuss more Hibernate interview questions and answers.